This just turned into a lounge down in Waikiki, obviously. No. Okay, no. Believe me, I would much rather sit on a stool and worship all morning. Maybe we should do that one day. Maybe we will do that one day. But I got a message that's too important that God has put on my heart. Everybody say to each other, Happy Palm Sunday.
Happy Palm Sunday.
Amen. How many of you agree that it's very important how you greet somebody? Amen?
Amen.
Hey, you know what's cool? The batteries on my iPad just went out. So maybe I was meant to sing all day.
You got it.
You can borrow somebody's Bible. Now I'm the type. Oh no, that's okay. I got an idea. That's why I get one phone.
Yeah.
That's why I have a phone that is linked to my iPad. See, that's why. That's why I went to private school. I figured this stuff out.
What school?
Cheryl. Can you go behind the curtain in my backpack on the side? There's my phone.
I'm the type of guy where I love to greet people as they walk into a room. How many of you are like that? I love it. Not only because it makes that person feel good, but it makes me feel good to greet them.
Yeah.
And you know what else I find is that when you greet people in the right way, it sets the tone for the rest of the room.
Yes.
Right?
Amen.
Right? Because I also experience the other part. Maybe that's why people like dogs so much. Because it doesn't matter what kind of day you had, right, Cheryl? Oh man, please pray for Cheryl and Mike. Their poor puppy went home to be with Jesus.
Aww.
After how many years?
18.
18 years.
Thank you, Cheryl.
And, I gotta preach fast. This one only get 12%. Hey, whatever happens, happens, okay?
Amen.
But it sets the tone for the rest of the room. Now, I was on the topic of dogs because I think dogs are awesome because doesn't matter what you did to them before you left for work. It doesn't matter what kind of day they had. It doesn't matter what kind of day you had. When you walk in that door, that dog comes to your jumping all over, because that dog is always happy to see you. Why can't we be like dogs to one another? Because sometimes you walk in the door after work and after a long day, you swing the door open and all you see is people on the couch with their heads in the phone.
Yeah. They don't even look up to you. I get that in my house.
Sets the tone for the home. Greeting someone with the Spirit of God especially is the best remedy for ushering in God's Spirit into a place. Somebody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'll go find this bugger. And if I don't, too bad, we're just going to jam them. Yeah, I'm not worried. One thing good about what God blessed me with is the gift of Portuguese. Amen. Is that a gift? Is that a... Try looking 1 Corinthians 12. Is that a spiritual gift?
It's a Portuguese gift.
Thank you. But today we're going to read, I believe, out of Luke. And we are going to talk about Jesus and his triumphant entry into Jerusalem. Well, if anything, I get my notes on the screen, eh? Oh, praise the Lord. Wait, I get him. I get him, but I don't get to see him. Luke 19, verses 28 through 44. Jesus is awaiting his triumphant entry. Now, I'm going to rewind the tape a little bit. Now, he's awaiting his triumphant entry into your heart this morning. But how will you welcome him? That's what we're going to talk about today. How will you welcome him? We can learn a lot when we read the scripture from Palm Sunday. Luke 19, 28 to 35. Did I put that one up there?
I got 32 to 35.
32 to 35. Let's read this. So they went and found the colt, just as Jesus had said. And sure enough, as they were untying it, the owner asked them, "Why are you untying that colt?" And the disciples simply replied, "The Lord needs it." So they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their garments over it for him to ride. You see, when Jesus was entering into Jerusalem, he told his disciples, it starts by saying, Jesus went towards Jerusalem, walking ahead of his disciples. As he came to the towns of Bethphage and Bethany on the Mount of Olives, he sent two disciples ahead. Yeah, and he said, "Go into the village over there," he told them. "As you enter it, you will see a young donkey and there that no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, why are you untying the colt? Just say the Lord needs it." So that's what precedes that. Now, verse 28 starts with the phrase, after telling this story. What story are they talking about? What story did Jesus tell right before he went into Jerusalem? And I think it's paired with this triumphant entry perfectly. So, you know what? Let me give you the reason why he told this story. He told the story of the parable of the money usage, or the parable of the 10 servants. Now, the reason why he told this story was to explain the return of God's kingdom is not a triumphant entry like a warrior king, but it will be a process. How many of you know that when God does something in your life, it's not usually bam, it's usually here you go, here's the process, I'll walk you through it, but there it is, and we're going to get there. I am like that with God, and I'm sure you are as well. It's important to know Jesus and his character. It's important to know his purpose and your role in God's bigger picture. Amen? The parable that he spoke before he entered Jerusalem had two main purposes: to teach stewardship, the need to manage gifts and resources well while King Jesus is away. You see, he's preparing the hearts of the disciples because he keeps telling them that he needs to go. He's going to get crucified, but they don't believe him. But he's trying to prepare them for his absence. If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother, Luke 14, 26 to 33 says, and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, and even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And I talk about this all the time. That's kind of harsh, Jesus. You're telling me for hate my wife? No. If you look at the Greek word for the word hate, it means just to love less. Yeah? It doesn't mean hate like we think in English. You know, Hebrew and Greek, kind of like Hawaiian, get kauna. Yeah? But the Greek word for what English calls hate is this Greek word that only means to love less. You need to love my, and I explain this all the time. I love Jesus more than Jamie. Now the reason why that needs to be is because if I don't, then I am trying to love my wife through my own idea of love. Or my own power of love. You know what? I'm not even going to try to go through these notes. Where's my son, Nalu? He's here. I'm going to use his Bible. And you also get big print. How about yours? Anybody get reading glasses? I don't like diamond time. Excuse me, Angang. I think I just gonna preach out of the word.
Love it.
Maybe that's what pastor should do.
Yeah.
Oh, thanks. Oh, I get Julie, I get. Thank you. Thanks, my dear. Sorry. Hold, Jesse, blind. No, I'm just kidding, because the buggy is perfect, actually. Okay, where are we? Luke 19?
Yeah.
14? 19?
32.
Okay, right here. Okay, I just go preach.
Amen.
Let's just throw away the notes. Join me in prayer. Father God, your purposes are perfect. You are intentional about everything you do. And you know what? I went try and dodge and weave your will for a couple of times just a minute ago. But I hear you loud and clear now. You're saying, forget about the notes that you prepared. I want to say something new to them today.
Yes.
So will you speak through me? Because I have no idea what you want to say. But we're just going to go through your word. And we're going to expound on it. And we're going to allow you to speak in Jesus' name. Amen. So check this out. He tells the parable of the, it says here, the parable of the minas. A certain nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and to return. So he called 10 of his servants, delivered to them 10 minas, and said to them, do business till I come. But his citizens hated him and sent a delegation after him saying, we will not have this man reign over us. And so it was that when he returned, having received the kingdom, he then commanded these servants to whom he had given the money to be called to him, that he might know how much every man had gained by trading. Then came the first saying, Master, your mina has earned 10 minas. And he said to him, well done, good servant, because you were faithful in a very little, I have have authority over 10 cities. And the second came saying, Master, your mina has earned 5 minas. Likewise, he said to him, you also be over 5 cities. Then another came saying, Master, here is your mina, which I have kept and put away in a handkerchief. For I feared you, because you are a mean man. You collect that you did not deposit, and reap what you did not sow. And he said to him, out of your own mouth I will judge you, you wicked servant. You knew that I was and mean man, collecting what I did not deposit and reaping what I did not sow. Why didn't you put my money in the bank? At my coming, I might have at least collected interest. And he said to those who stood by, take the mina from him and give it to him who has 10 minas. But they said to him, Master, he has 10 minas already. For I say to you, that to everyone who has will be given, and from him who does not have, even what he has will be taken away from him. But bring here those enemies of mine who did not want me to reign over them, and slay them before me. Now, this might be a crazy story to tell before you enter Jerusalem triumphantly, but like I said before, I believe this is connected to the triumphant entry. I believe he was preparing his believers, he was preparing his disciples, that you need to, when I leave this earth, when I am crucified, dead and buried, when I rise again, and when I resurrect to sit at the right hand of the Father, I will send the Holy Spirit, but you guys need to have a certain heart posture. You guys need to have a certain frame of mind. You guys can't sit on the sidelines. You guys can't sit up in the stands. You got to take what I have given you and start investing it in the kingdom. Yes. Not in yourself, not in the world, but start using what you got for the kingdom of God. And I think it was important to him to train up his disciples before he entered Jerusalem. Everybody got you? Got me on that one?
Amen.
Amen. I just had lunch with a dear brother that goes to this church, and he's going to step up and do something so important for our church that we've been praying for such a long time, that the words out of his mouth was exactly this. He said, "Pastor, for so many years, I've been wanting to do something. And I heard you say one Sunday that everybody has something they can give. Well, I'd like to step up and do this." And I thought, this is the exact thing I've been praying for years. Yes. You see, you might be sitting on something that God needs. You might be wrapping your minas in a handkerchief and keeping them in your back pocket, thinking that it's not good enough to offer to the Lord. But can I say to you, if you can walk, you can talk, you can wave, you can smile even, God will use it.
Amen. Amen.
You have something to use for the glory of God. Okay, let's move on. So, let's backtrack to talk about what we just talked about. So, oh man, I just gonna preach over here, okay? Now, so, let me recap what happened. He tells the parable. Then they're walking towards Jerusalem. He walks a little ways in front of his disciples. Then he turns to them and says, when you guys go inside the city, yeah, Bethany, right, Bethphage, go in. He sent two disciples. He said, you know why he sent two? Because every time God does something, he usually wants a witness. Because if one guy came back and said, wow, look what happened. Everybody go, yeah, right.
Yeah.
But if he sent two and a miracle happened, they both come back with a counting that nobody can doubt. That's part of it. And plus, he sent two to, you know, watch each other's back just in case beef. Nah. So he said, go into the city and there's going to be a colt. Or a young horse, or in some cases, some translations say one donkey that hasn't been ridden, pure. Just untie them. Just untie them and take them. And if anybody stops you and says, hey, where are you going with my horse? All you gotta tell them is, the master is of need of it, and they'll let you go. Now imagine these two guys. I would be kind of scared. You ever try walking to somebody's yard and just take something of theirs and they'll walk right out? That's just like me telling you, come on, go take Stuart. I'll let you guys go inside 33447 Duval Street. Walk in the house. Huh? You see a 70-inch TV. Just take them. And then when you guys leaving, if they ask you anything, just tell them, oh, Pastor Sam said, can't take home. You think they're gonna believe you? No. They're gonna call the cops, they're gonna try to tackle you. Well, that's why I'm gonna say you don't come because you come. But what is the miracle in this? When you greet Jesus today, the first thing we gotta realize is that He is your sole provider. What do I mean by that? In this scenario, you two brothers, go get the donkey, bring him back to me. Just untie him. You'll be in front of the guy's house, but just take him. In legal terms or in society, what would they call it? Stealing. So if you're reading through the Bible and you're going, "Hold Jesus, so what? You condoning stealing now? You telling your disciples to steal?" This is the process I was going through in my brain. But you know what? I came to a revelation. Jesus is God. Jesus owns everything. So you cannot steal from yourself. Nothing that we own, this shirt, my Crocs, these jeans, this Bible, this equipment, your dress, your car, your home if you own a home, your possessions, all belong to Jesus. So if he needs it, he takes it. Because it ain't yours in the first place. When we tithe and we go, "Oh, it's so hard to give the $5. And we spend $200 at Regal Theaters. We'll go see movies. We go, you know what? Just remember next time, it's not yours anyway. That's his. And when you give him what he already owns, guess what? A blessing comes. Not because you gave. Not because his love is transactional. It's because of your heart is submitted and your heart is trusting and you got this principle that he owns everything. And because I give, I'm not going to be without because he supplies my needs, not nobody else. Amen? Amen? Amen. So the disciples weren't stealing the donkey because he owned the donkey. So when we greet Jesus today, what was my first point? It was something to do with that. Greet him as provider. Penny. Yeah, Donald. Jesus is the owner and provider. See, there you go. All right. Okay, let's move on. So they go in verse 34, and they said, "The Lord has need of it." Then they brought him to Jesus, and they threw their own clothes on the colt. And they set Jesus on him. So they put Jesus on the colt. And as he went, many spread their clothes on the road. Then as he was now drawing near to descend up to the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works they had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest." It's close. When he reached the place where the road started down the Mountain of Olives, all of his followers began to shout and sing as they walked along, praising God for all the wonderful miracles they had seen. Blessing on the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven. I want to point out two words that I mentioned in these two versions of Scripture. One says followers, and the other one says believers. Okay? So it said the multitude of believers or his followers, these were the ones praising and singing his name. Yeah? And shouting Hosanna in the highest. Now why is that important? I'm going to get to that in just a little bit. Next slide, please, Ben. When we welcome Jesus, Jesus is worthy King. People are starting to understand who this Jesus really is. Towards the end of his ministry, this is not no ordinary prophet. He is being recognized as the Messiah. Now, not everybody recognized him as the Messiah. Some people were a little confused. In fact, some people were a little bit hoo-hoo. Because in their minds, yeah, the Jews were waiting for a coming king. So when they pictured a coming king victorious, their expectation of God was of him coming in on a white horse in armor carrying a sword. Did Jesus enter Jerusalem like that? No, he didn't. He entered on a colt or a young horse or a donkey or you know, a mule. And he came humbly. If you do some historical study, there is proof that there was a custom when the king entered the city on a colt, it meant that there was peace across the land, as opposed to him riding in with sword in hand and shield, which meant they were at war. So Jesus, using their culture, painted a picture that he came not to kill, but to bring peace, the peace of the Lord over them. And he came as a humble servant, not a conquering king. He will conquer death. He will conquer the important parts, but he's not going to conquer the way he thinks. So another point here could be that we might expect Jesus to be something, but we need room in our heart for an understanding of who he really is. How many of us expect God to answer our prayer just like that? How many of us expect Jesus sometime? We expect him to be like the blue genie in the lamp, where we rub the lamp, we make our wish, and we say, okay, God, where is it? That's not the kind of Messiah that Jesus really is. He didn't come to conquer people. He came to conquer death. And he came to conquer hearts. Yeah? So he comes. Welcome him as conquering king. Let's move on. And here we go. There are other people in this big crowd. It says right here in 39, and some of the Pharisees called to him from the crowd, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples," they said. Because they're making too much noise. They're shouting things that maybe they shouldn't. I think some of the Pharisees were feeling really uncomfortable. Before I got saved, if you talked about Jesus around me, I felt uncomfortable. Because I didn't know Jesus. But when we come to the point in our life where we accept him as our Lord and Savior, and we busting at the seams about how good he is, sometimes we cannot help. When I was in the honeymoon period of my faith, you know what I mean, right? Yeah. The first 6 months after you get saved, I was trying to get everybody to come to my church. You nuts, bro. What, you want Jesus free? Yeah. It makes people uncomfortable. So these Pharisees, so-called church guys, sometimes even church guys get uncomfortable when you say Jesus. Come on now. Some of the Pharisees called out to him from the crowd, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." But he answered and said to them, "I tell you that if these should keep silent, the stones would immediately cry out." That means that there is nothing that will hold back the praise and the worship when the king starts coming to town.
Amen.
Amen. Now as he drew near, he saw the city. Now you got to imagine this. The majority was singing praises. crying out, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. There was a, you know, the few Pharisees that were complaining and murmuring in the crowd. But we get to a point here where Jesus really shows his heart and his love. Because did Jesus die for everybody?
Yes.
Did Jesus even die for our enemies?
Yes.
Did Jesus die for the ones who hurt us?
Yes.
It says here, now as he drew near, he saw the city. And it says here that he wept over it. He said this, if you had known, and he's talking to the people, he's talking over the city. If you have only known, even you, especially in this, your day, the things that make for you your peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes, for days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment around you, surround you, and close you in on every side, and level you and your children within you to the ground. And they will not leave in you one stone upon another, because you did not know the time of your visitation. He wept. He wept over the city, because even though this large group of believers got it, the children of Israel as a whole didn't get it. They're missing it. They're not realizing who is walking in their midst. Church, what I want to say to you today before I close is, don't fall asleep when Jesus is in your midst. I'm going to come back to value, putting value on the King. If Jesus Christ walked through these doors right now, what would your posture be like? What would be your attitude? What would be your reaction? If I saw Jesus in a flaming glory light walk right down right past Freddy Boy right there, I drop to my knees and worship. Or I get up to my feet and rejoice. I run and embrace him. So why in God's name, when you're in the presence of Jesus Christ, do we fall asleep? We should be jumping for joy. You guys looking at me like Jesus is not here. He's sitting there. 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 He's right here. He's right next to me. He's whispering in my ear what to say.
Amen, Jesus. Amen.
You guys don't get it. You get it?
Yeah,
get
it. Hallelujah.
God sent him to die for you. That's what we're celebrating this week. Jesus cried because the majority didn't get it. He's calling out to each one of you this morning saying, I'm here. Can you see me? I died for you. I love you. I want to bless you. So why are you lulled to sleep by society? Why are you lulled to sleep by social media? Why are you lulled to sleep by other people's opinions about me? I am real. Read my word. I love you. I want to break through for you. I'm real. I'm not one fairy tale. I'm not one story. I'm the real deal. And I'm here. So stand up. And recognize the King when he walks into the room. Hallelujah.
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 Let's stand. Stand and welcome the Lord. Stand and welcome the Lord. Stand and welcome the Lord. Give him a love. Welcome him with all your might right now. Come on. Yes, Lord. I don't even know what my last point was. It may not even matter. But Jesus is a loving Savior. So when we welcome him, welcome the loving Savior. Hallelujah. I want to pray for you right now. I'm going to pray. And by the way, I wasn't yelling at those of you who was kind of dozing off during this one. I was talking spiritually. I was talking about us when we leave. And I'm not talking just to you. I'm looking in the mirror on this one too. I think we take Jesus' Savior, his saving power, and I think we take his love and his grace for granted when we leave the church. I think we forget that he is in our presence at all time. And all I want to remind you is that, be reminded that he is here next to you all the time. I want everybody to bow their head. Close your eyes. If you've been sleeping in your walk with Christ and you want a wake-up call today, I want to pray with you. All eyes closed, all heads bowed. On the count of three, I want you to raise your hand if you want to recommit your life to Christ or you want to receive him for the first time to wake up out of this slumber, to ignite a fire in your faith. I want you to shoot a hand up on the count of three, okay? All eyes closed, okay? No look. No look. This is only between you and the Lord. Nobody else, okay? Close your eyes, bow your heads. One, two, three. Shoot them up, shoot them up, shoot them up, shoot them up. There you go. I see you. 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 Okay, put your hands down. Everybody repeat after me. Dear Lord,
dear Lord,
thank you for Jesus.
Thank you for Jesus.
Thank you for sending him.
Thank you for
having him die on the cross for my sins. I am not worthy. I ask for your forgiveness. And I ask you, Jesus, to be my King today and forevermore. I ask, Jesus, that you wake me up in my spirit to live for you. Not only on Sunday, but every minute of my life. I will recognize you in my presence every minute of every hour. Thank you, Lord. I say this so you can hear me. I say this so my neighbor can hear. I say this so the church can hear. I say this so the devil can hear. Jesus Christ is my King, and Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior forever and ever. Amen. Somebody give him a shout today.